ETF Prime is hosted by investment advisors at the ETF Store and sponsored by Legg Mason. Legg Mason's sponsorship is not an endorsement nor a recommendation for any product or service. Legg Mason Investor Services LLC is not affiliated with the ETF Store, ETF.com, or any of its affiliates. The ETF Store is not affiliated with ETF.com or any of its affiliates. ETF.com's participation in this program should not be construed as an endorsement or an indication by ETF.com of the value of any ETF Store product or service. This program is for informational purposes only and does not constitute investment advice. All investing involves risk, including the potential loss of principal. Past performance is no guarantee of future results. The ETF Store owns and is responsible for all program content. Visit ETFstore.com for more information.
Legg Mason is a leading global investment company committed to helping clients reach their financial goals through long-term actively managed strategies. Legg Mason offers a broad range of equity, fixed income, alternative, and cash strategies worldwide. It is comprised of a diverse family of specialized investment managers, each with their own independent approach to research and analysis, and has over a century of experience in identifying opportunities and delivering astute investment solutions to clients. To learn more, please visit LeggMason.com.
Now it's time for ETF Prime, where we discuss everything you need to know about exchange-traded funds and the world of investing. Whether you're an investing expert or just starting out, Nate will help you get up to date with what's happening on Wall Street and show you how exchange-traded funds can help lower your investment costs, reduce your tax bill, and allow you to take advantage of investment opportunities around the world. And now, the host of ETF Prime, Nate Geraci.
All right, really nice show lined up. As always, I want to thank our exclusive sponsor, Legg Mason. So last week, I ran a Twitter poll, as I've been known to do from time to time. And actually, it was two polls. So in the first poll, I simply asked, what was the best reason for ESG investing or ESG ETFs? Of course, ESG stands for environmental, social, and governance. This is socially responsible investing. And the options I gave were, number one, to alter corporate behavior. Number two, express personal beliefs. Number three, generate outperformance. And then four was none, that ESG is a marketing gimmick. Now listen to this, 50% chose marketing gimmick. Express personal beliefs was a second with 27%. I then ran the exact same poll, only this time I asked for the worst reason for ESG investing. Again, same options here. And 49% chose generate outperformance as the worst reason to use ESG ETFs. Express personal beliefs was again number two with 21%. And look, obviously these aren't scientific polls, right? Who knows what the composition of my Twitter followers is. But I found this really interesting because we are seeing a pickup in dollars flowing into ESG ETFs. They continue to receive a lot of attention. However, there's still this debate around whether ESG investing really makes a difference. And there's also a question of whether you're sacrificing returns. On the show this week, I'll be joined by ETF.com's Laura Krieger, who covers the ESG ETF space as well as anyone, anywhere. And what I want to do is first get Laura's take on my little Twitter poll, which I'm very interested in hearing. And then we're going to get into this debate a bit and talk about some of the different viewpoints around ESG. We'll also take a look at those ESG ETF flows I alluded to, and we'll discuss a couple of pieces Laura recently wrote on ESG bond ETFs, which I don't think get nearly the same attention as the equity side. So we'll start with that, and then later I'm going to switch gears and be joined by Sean Brown, CEO of YCharts, who's an up-and-coming investment research platform. We're going to discuss the importance of ETF due diligence, making sure you're doing all the proper homework when selecting ETFs. And Sean's going to highlight some of the tools YCharts offers to help with this. And I think more importantly, he's going to explain some of the key factors here, what you should be looking at to find the right ETFs for your portfolio. So great show this week. As always, if you have questions or comments, you can visit etfprime.com or you can find me on Twitter at Nate Geraci. Let's start this week with ETF.com's Laura Krieger.
Time now for our weekly chat with the experts at ETF.com, the world's leading independent authority on ETFs.
I ran the numbers again for the cheapest ESG ETF portfolio. These are good numbers. They're not marijuana good, but they're pretty good. If you believe that it's going to save you in the apocalypse, you might want to consider something else.
Laura, so as I mentioned, we're going to get into ESG ETF flows. I also want to ask you about a couple of pieces you recently wrote on ESG bond ETFs. But I do have to first get your reaction to my highly scientific Twitter poll. Does it surprise you that 50% see no reason for ESG investing? You know, they basically think ESG is an outright marketing gimmick.
I don't mean to pop a needle in the balloon here, but I think it says more about the skepticism of FinTwit and the people who are extremely online than it says anything about particular trends in ESG investing, because the fact of the matter is ESG investing is already enormous in the mutual fund space, where by some estimates, it accounts for one out of every $4 invested worldwide. And it's gaining popularity in the ETF space. We've had a number of ESG ETFs debut this year. So far this year, the whole space has taken in almost $8 billion, which is more than they took in last year. And out of the 90 socially responsible ETFs out there, only 20% of them are actually negative for the year. Negative in terms of flows for the year. All the others are up. So there is interest. There is a growing interest. Back to the points that you made earlier about, you know, the best and the worst reasons for investing, I have to kind of weigh in my own thoughts on
Please.
That.
Please.
The best reason, I think, for investing in ESG ETFs is if you are already inclined to be an impact investor, an ESG investor, ETFs take out the hard work for you. They take on the valuation of stocks according to ESG criteria. They do the hard work of building and constructing a portfolio and doing all the rebalancing and the trading and stuff. They just make it so much easier. It's the same reason anybody would use any ETF, right? And the worst reason to invest in them, in my opinion, is if you're not inclined to be an impact investor and you are only investing in these because you think you're going to ride some sort of hot, popular marijuana-esque trend and, you know, find the next fund that's going to hit it big, I think that's not going to happen. And it's probably, you know, maybe kind of in the same category as the people. You can count me in the same category as the people who state that generating outperformance is probably not the best reason to invest in ESG ETFs. Because, no, I think maybe I'm not quite as skeptical about that as maybe the people who are answering your poll. But, you know, I do think thinking about ESG ETFs as the next big hot trend, it's not the reason to invest.
Laura, I know you and I have gone back and forth on ESG many times, and we could probably debate this for, I don't know, an hour or longer. But I think in a nutshell, the argument from non-believers is it just doesn't move the needle, right? Not owning a small fraction of shares in your IRA or whatever isn't going to change corporate behavior. And not only that, to your point on underperformance, I think you are risking underperformance because you're limiting the investment universe and you could deviate from the indexes. Now, you could also have outperformance because of that, but certainly underperformance is a risk. And so I think it boils down to why not just boycott companies who you disagree with, right? Don't buy their products or services, or maybe better, donate money to actionable causes to help whatever you believe in. I think overall, that's the negative side of the argument. You mentioned one positive in terms of, you know, ETFs have taken the hard work out of being able to get exposure to ESG. But you know, from your perspective, what's the bigger picture positive side of ESG?
Okay, there's a whole lot that I have to unpack in what you just said. So first, let me kind of take it step by step. So you mentioned that a lot of people think that not owning shares of a company isn't really going to move the needle, and that's fair, but it's also a misinterpretation of what ESG investing is all about for the majority of investors who engage in it, right? So sure, Vanguard or BlackRock has maybe the clout to force companies to behave in one way or another, but you and me, we don't, right? So ESG investing to the retail investor, to the small advisor who maybe has 50 or 100 million in assets, for them, ESG isn't trying to change the world. No more than deciding not to purchase goods from Walmart is about you single-handedly trying to change Walmart's labor practices, right? It's about withholding your financial support from companies that are doing things that you don't agree with and redirecting your capital towards companies that you do support. So you personally can sleep sounder at night. And, you know, if enough people do the same, maybe it changes corporate behavior, maybe it doesn't, but at least you personally can rest easy knowing that you aren't funding those labor abuses or private prisons or whatever, you know, is your cause du jour. So, and I would point out that as investors, as consumers, we tend to make these sorts of value judgments all the time in almost every purchase that we make. So why is it suddenly a bad thing when it's applied to, you know, an attempt to apply capitalism in an ethical way, you know? To the point about sacrificing returns, you know, I think that that assertion is also a misunderstanding because most ESG ETFs out there, they're not smart beta products, right? They're not promising alpha over and above what you could get through just a broad market ETF. Most ESG products are built explicitly to replicate market returns as closely as possible, just without any of the securities that folks are going to find objectionable. So, you know, you aren't going to see great outperformance. You might not see any outperformance whatsoever. You know, even with that in mind, however, I ran the numbers, and of the 70 equity ETFs with track records, at least to the first of the year, roughly half of them outperformed or were at least within 1% of SPY. And, you know, the ones that weren't tended to be the narrower thematic funds, and that could be true of any thematic fund, whether it's ESG or not. You go out to 3 years, your available pool of ETFs shrinks considerably, right? But it's the same ratio, right? About half, again, of equity ETFs keep up with or beat SPY. So smart beta ETFs would kind of kill for that sort of performance. Yet you don't hear anybody going on and on about the existential problem of, you know, investing in smart beta ETFs.
Yeah, and I think the issue, though, is that you do have the risk of underperformance. And this is just one data point. You gave data for whatever, 70 ETFs. But I saw Bloomberg's Eric Balchunas point this out last week. He noted that the iShares MSCI USA ESG Select Social Index Fund index, which is behind SUSA, which maybe we can talk about a little bit later. But that's trailing the S&P 500 by 35% over the past 10 years. And he mentioned how a primary reason for that is because it doesn't own Amazon, which has obviously been a key contributor to the S&P's performance. So, you know, I think when you hear the talk around performance, I think for me, it's just that you do have that potential risk of underperformance. But, you know, going back to your point on, you know, whether owning a few shares in a retirement account makes a big difference, or I guess that was my point in your rebuttal. It's my belief that that's not really going to move the cost of capital for these companies, right? I mean, these shares are trading on the secondary market. Companies have already raised capital. And so you swapping shares or not owning shares with another investor is not going to move the needle there. You know, maybe on the bond side, that could be a little bit different, but no, go ahead.
I understand what you're saying, and you're right, but that's not why people are doing it. People aren't doing it so that they can change companies. They're doing it so that they personally can sleep better at night, knowing that their money isn't going to support something that they don't like.
Right. It's that express personal beliefs.
Mm-hmm.
Well, okay. So let me ask you this. So on that note, do you think an ESG investor who, let's say their ESG ETF doesn't own Walmart, your example earlier, right? Let's say Walmart doesn't pass the ETF's ESG screens for employment practices or whatever. Do you think that investor should also avoid using Walmart services just to be consistent? I just wonder if people are actually doing that in practice.
I think that if you're an impact investor who specifically selected an ESG ETF because it avoids Walmart stock, then yeah, I think you're probably not too keen on Walmart as a company, and you're probably not shopping there. But usually I think it works the other way around. I think rather than your investment choices informing your consumption choices, usually it's your consumption choices that are informing your investments, because, you know, your discretionary cash is what you deal with on a day-to-day basis, and it's much more top of mind. So, you know, if you are inclined to not shop at Walmart for ethical reasons, then you're probably going to seek out an ESG ETF that, you know, if you knew about it, right? If you know that there are these options out there, you would be more inclined to go for an ETF that doesn't have Walmart in it. Now, you made a point earlier about how investors should just, you know, wouldn't it be better to just boycott companies that you don't agree with? And I wanted to step back to that because I don't think it has to be an either or, right? You don't have to either donate to a good cause or invest in ESG. And in fact, I believe that investors who, you know, from the people that I've spoken to over the years, the advisors, the investors I've spoken to who are ESG investors, they believe strongly enough in the promise of impact investing that they have strong enough convictions, they want to be a very consistent investor. So they're probably applying those principles to other aspects of their life as much as they can. They are probably not shopping at Walmart, you know, just to be as part of a holistic, you know, if labor practices matter to them, they are probably very involved in labor charities and they're not, you know, buying things at Walmart and they want, you know, an ETF that doesn't have Walmart in it if they think that strongly about these things. So, yeah.
So I agree that there's a whole bunch of people out there who probably have that viewpoint. Because of that, do you think ETF issuers or fund companies as a whole are specifically marketing products that I know this term greenwashing gets thrown around where because they know that that investor is out there who may have an interest in this, they're rolling out these products. But when you peel back what they actually own, there are some inconsistencies there. So I know some of the ESG ETFs, for instance, will own oil companies, will own Exxon, which may be incongruent with somebody's personal beliefs on obviously ESG. So do you feel like fund companies are maybe taking advantage of this in a negative way?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And it's not just me who thinks that, right? It's you talk to any advisor who's trying to use ESG principles in their practice, they all, almost to the person, complain about greenwashing in the ESG ETF space. And it's a problem that's just going to get worse, to be honest, because the more interest there is in the space from investors, the more that fund companies are going to want to get their own slice of the pie, right? They can read the writing on the wall. They know that, you know, there's a great groundswell of interest in this, and you know, they're going to start putting out their own products, but they're not experts in ESG. And there's also the issue of what, and I hate that we have to talk about this every single time we talk about ESG, but what does ESG mean, right? Sonia Dreisler, who is somebody I interviewed for the site last month, she had a great breakdown of ESG versus impact versus SRI. ESG, when you hear the term ESG, you should think data. It's all about data. When you hear the term SRI or socially responsible investing, you should think values. This is about investing your values. And when you hear the term impact investing is about intention. It's about what you intend to do with your capital. And I think there's a lot of muddying of the waters between those three. We tend to use them interchangeably, and investors tend to think of them interchangeably, but they're really not. And I think maybe a lot of the issues of greenwashing, you know, quote unquote greenwashing, really come down to just not clearly defining what your product is basing its portfolio on. You know, it's not clearly defined whether this is, in investors' minds, I should say, it's not clearly communicated to the investor that this is an ESG product, a data-based product versus an intention-based product or a values-based product.
I think that's a great point, and I think that's something that has hurt the space, that there's not a term that investors can easily understand or grab onto. I think another issue is just talking about ESG data. There are so many different ESG data sources out there right now, yeah. And those data sources may have different criteria for what constitutes ESG or what, you know, what level a company's operating on a particular ESG factor. I think that's a real problem as well, just to make, you know, defining what is ESG at the data level.
Mm-hmm. I 100% agree.
All right. Well, in any event, so clearly investors are interested in ESG ETFs. You alluded to this earlier, because even though the overall assets in ESG ETFs are small, we are seeing flows in the space. I guess give us an update here. What are you seeing in terms of ESG flows this year?
Right. So I think I mentioned at the top that about $8 billion has come into the space thus far. Most of that is concentrated into a number of already large equity ETFs that are promising equity or broad market-like returns, right? Like we were talking about earlier. You mentioned the iShares ESG MSCI USA Leaders ETF, which is ticker SUSA, S-U-S-A. These names, man, just tripling over these names. that one was in a kind of a race to $1 billion with the Xtrackers MSCI USA ESG Leaders Equity ETF. That's ticker USSG. Both of them have about $1.5 billion. They've seen about $1.5 billion in flows so far this year. There's a number of other iShares products and Vanguard products, actually. The two Vanguard ESG ETFs have seen some substantial flows as well. But there's really no surprise here to me that BlackRock and Vanguard ETFs would be the ones to attract the most capital. They are the two largest ESG or two largest ETF providers on the market. Of course, most of the capital is going to go their way. And it's not surprising to me either that it's the replacement, the so-called like replacement ETFs, the ones that you can use to sub out your vanilla equity exposure in the broadest swaths in the market, the U.S. equity market, that these are the ones that are going to be the biggest draws either. I don't really see any big surprises in that. So,
I saw last week in the ETF.com live chat, your colleague Dave Noddick, he said he thinks ESG will be a slow burn. So he expects assets to just sort of grind their way higher. And he thinks it's inevitable that over a 15, 20-year period, as we see boomers transfer their wealth to the next generation, he thinks more money will end up in ESG funds. Do you agree that that's how it's going to play out? Even though we've seen this, you know, really high growth rate this year, it's been off a small asset base, but just in terms of the overall growth trajectory, is that how you see it playing out, a slow burn?
Slow burn, I think of it as a snowball rolling down the mountain, right? So for a good long part of that snowball's trajectory, it's going to be pretty tiny. And it's going to consistently grow and grow. But by the end, it's going to be enormous, right? And cause an avalanche. So that's sort of what we've seen thus far in the ESG ETF space. We've seen consistent year over year growth in the double digits. I think from 2017 to 2018, it was something like 30% asset growth. But like you said, the asset base was pretty tiny. So, you know, that number doesn't really sound too impressive when you're talking about only a couple billion. But it's been that way for several years. It's been consistently in the 20 to 30% growth over year for however long these funds have been around. And if it continues at that growth rate, you're going to see the avalanche sooner rather than later, you know?
What do you think could be some drivers here? Is it more education around ESG? I know you were talking about the terms earlier, which I agree is an issue. So maybe more education around that and just what ESG investing is. Or do you think it comes down to investors realizing that perhaps they can express their personal beliefs through ETFs? I'm just curious what you think the longer term drivers will be to get more people into ESG ETFs.
So I think there's a couple of drivers. What you said is very apt, right? There is an education gap and there needs to be more and more advisors are talking to their investors and more investors are researching this on their own. Two other things that I think are going to be kind of a big thing is one, institutional interest, right? Worldwide, institutions are driving ESG investment in mutual fund space and in indexing and so on and so forth. And that's what you've seen in the ESG ETF space this year. The two top flows getters, SUSA, USSG, they were backed by a large Finnish pension company, basically created these two custom funds just for them. Institutional money is going to continue to drive it. The other thing I think that might be a little overlooked is the fact that many of these funds are still fairly new. They've been launched in the last maybe year or two, but that's not long enough in terms of track record to get on many platforms for advisors, investors. So once those track records get long enough, once the asset bases get long enough, you're going to see them show up on more platforms. And that, I think, is going to be a game changer. Once people have access to these funds, you know, more education for sure, but there's also the access problem too. So once these funds get big enough and have been around long enough to show up on some of the most popular platforms, then absolutely that's going to unlock some doors.
Well, and also if those track records look pretty good, right? To the point on performance mm-hmm. earlier, if performance isn't being sacrificed, that'll clearly help, I think, in elevating the space. Laura, we have a couple of minutes left. I do want to quickly ask you about two pieces you recently wrote on ESG bond ETF. So I think most people tend to think of ESG stock ETFs, but there is a growing number of bond ETF options available as well, including something called green bonds. And as skeptical as maybe I come across on ESG overall, I do think this is an area where you can clearly see the potential impact. You want to explain what green bonds are?
Sure. I think this is fascinating to me. I'm really interested in these. So green bond ETFs aren't normally, they're not what you normally think of as what an ESG fixed income ETF would be, where you would take a bond index and then screen it using some exclusionary criteria, kick out all of the bad bonds and keep the good bonds, right? Green bonds are a special kind of bond category that are designed to fund specific climate change mitigating projects. So you'll have a green bond that funds a city converting its public transit to a zero emission bus fleet, or a green bond that finances a solar farm, right? So very specific projects. And unlike most ESG investing, which is, you know, as we talked about, making sure that you're not supporting companies that you disagree with, green bond funds are very much a way to direct your capital towards projects that you support. It's very much impact investing at its purest. So there are two green bond ETFs on the market right now. There's GRNB, that's a Van Eck Vectors Green Bond Fund, and BGRN, which is from iShares, that's the iShares Green Bond Fund. The Van Eck one is older. It's a purer play. It uses green bonds that have been certified by a third party nonprofit. But the iShares one is bigger and more liquid. So, you know, you can get more into the details of what's in each portfolio and weigh it for yourself. But there are two options out there and they're very interesting.
So. No, I agree. These are interesting because, again, to your point, the debt is allocated specifically towards environmentally friendly projects. So this is a case where your dollars are directly impacting a particular cause. So I think this will be an interesting space to watch. You also had a piece on how advisors are using ESG bond ETFs overall, not necessarily just green bond ETFs, but ETFs running similar screens to what we've talked about on the equity side. So these ETFs will hold, you know, the bonds of companies scoring high on environmental or social issues or whatever. I'm just curious, anything in particular stand out as you interviewed these various advisors? I feel like you had maybe four or five advisors in the piece you wrote.
Yeah, and I actually spoke to some advisors that I didn't end up making, you know, that I didn't end up including in the piece. And I think one of the most consistently fascinating and surprising things to me is just how consistent and creative folks get when applying the principles of ESG investing. And I say that because they come up with some fairly remarkable applications that never would have occurred to me. I speak to advisors whose clients don't want to invest in treasuries, for example, U.S. treasuries, because they don't want to support the U.S. government's stance on, you know, endless wars or them pulling from the Paris Climate Accords. And that's, I'm sure we could have a whole discussion just on that. I speak to advisors who use muni bonds as a way to get super granular into their fixed income investing, supporting only the states, the cities, even the municipalities that or individual projects that they want to, they feel are consistent with their ESG principles. I mean, there's a whole universe out there of, say, racial justice investing, where states might put up a bond to pay for the legal defense of a police officer on trial for shooting an unarmed Black person. And there are people out there who make it their mission to identify these bonds and categorize them for investors who want to explicitly avoid investing in them. And that's just incredible to me. The amount of dedication it takes to do something like that is really just incredible. And it makes me excited to see what creative takes on ESG are still out there available for the ETF industry. It really just makes me interested and excited to see the future of this space going forward, because we haven't even begun to scratch the surface of what's possible in ESG ETFs.
Laura, you interview a ton of advisors on all sorts of different topics. Was it difficult to find advisors who were using ESG bond ETFs?
Oh, God, no. No. I was surprised, actually, because, there's only 9 bond ETFs in the ESG ETF space. And I expected to have to dig a little bit more deeply into the advisor pool. But no, people were coming out of the woodwork to say, yeah, we use the Nuveen products, we use the green bond products, we use these other products that I wouldn't even consider. In my mind, I wouldn't have considered them as ESG ETFs, like the Muni, PIMCO's Muni ETF, or Invesco has a BAB, the Invesco, it used to be the Build America Bonds ETF. It's the taxable municipal securities ETF now. I wouldn't have thought of those as green ETFs or ESG ETFs, but they made a very compelling case as for why these funds meet their ESG screens. So maybe moving forward, you'll see more conversation among ESG-minded investors, less about using specifically ESG-branded ETFs or marketed as ESG ETFs, and more about how to apply ESG principles to investment as a whole. And even if something's not marketed specifically as an ESG product, here's how it fits anyway, right? So a lot of interesting conversations going on.
Well, Laura, fantastic stuff as always this week. I really mean it. You cover this space as well as anyone anywhere. And I just find this entire ESG topic so fascinating. There's no question, and I know I say this every time, we're going to continue to have conversations about this. I think to your point and speaking to advisors, how you didn't have a hard time finding them, and you see this interest here. Clearly, there is a subset right now that has a high interest in ESG. So just going to be fascinated to watch this unfold. But really appreciate you joining us this week. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me on.
That was ETF.com's Laura Krieger. All right, I'm now very pleased to be joined by Sean Brown, CEO of YCharts, which is an investment research platform really focused on helping investors make better decisions and helping advisors better communicate with their clients. Sean is on the line with us from Chicago. Sean, great having you on the show this week.
Hey, Nate. Thanks for having me.
Sean, so we're going to talk ETF due diligence, but I'm always curious to hear the backstory on businesses like YCharts, because clearly you're gaining a ton of traction with investors. You've seen a lot of success thus far. So what is the backstory here? How did YCharts come to be?
Yeah, so YCharts came into being in 2010. Saw an interesting opportunity in the market to sit between the very, very expensive tools built on some older technologies that are cost, $20,000, $25,000 per seat. And then the other end of the market is the free tools, the Yahoo Finance and the Google Finances, which are easy to use but not very deep. Saw a neat opportunity there to help the retail sector, the wealth advisors, asset managers, and came into being that way and have grown quite a bit since then.
And so just at a high level for people unfamiliar with the platform itself, and we'll get into the ETF side of the equation in a moment, but high level, how do you like to describe what YCharts does?
Yeah, I think we do a couple things. We enable smarter investment decisions, and we support great communications of investment research. And the way we do that is in a bit of a Swiss Army knife for research. So everything between dashboards to screeners to charting tools to ties into Microsoft Excel to tons of economic indicators and data, a big package of things that helps make investments and communications easier.
Okay, so let's get into this topic of ETF due diligence. And I think a good place to start might be to just point out that there are currently 2,300 plus exchange traded products available. And of course, that number seems to grow, geez, every single week. What do you hear from advisors on this? Given the growth of ETFs, where do the pain points seem to be right now on filtering through the ETF universe?
Yeah, it's interesting. The world works, especially the investment and asset management space, works to make the life of investors a little bit easier, right? We went from a world of stocks to a world of mutual funds, all of which have pros and cons, to a world of ETFs, which has some fantastic benefits. But the thing we keep hearing is, yeah, but help me sort through the complexity. How do I get more quickly to what I'm looking for? Because at the end of the day, making an investment is fundamentally a bit of an insecure decision. You got to press buy. And you want to make sure you've done your research and you feel confident in your decision. But I think we hear from investors all the time saying, how do I get from the 2,000 or 3,000 choices I've got in ETFs down to a few that I can make as final candidates and then pick the one and have confidence when I recommend it or buy?
Okay, so let's talk about that process, because I think the starting point should always be, what are you trying to accomplish in your portfolio, right? You have to decide which asset classes you want to own and then go from there. You obviously don't want to get this backwards. You don't start with a list of ETFs, pick out what you like, and then try to shoehorn them into a portfolio. But assuming you've done that piece and you have a sound investment thesis, talk about the process from there. How should an investor go about selecting ETFs?
Yeah, and you just described, you know, I liken ETF selection a little bit to buying a home. And just like you're saying, like, you don't start with going and placing an offer. You start with saying some subjective things like, you know, do they have good schools? Do I want a big yard? What's the crime rate? You know, does the community have a nice rec center? How long is my commute going to be? You get that stuff nailed down, and then you can get into the metrics in a home of, you know, what's the cost per square foot. You can go to Zillow and check comparables and property taxes and all of these things. So it's just like buying a home, that once you have the subjective things nailed down, then you need to screen for a manageable list of a subset of 2,500 to 3,000 ETFs. Get it down to a subset. And I can talk through, you know, some approaches to getting it down to a subset. And then once you have a subset, you're able to do some deep dive research, which helps you make the selection that's right for you or your clients.
No, I'd love to hear. Walk us through how you would get down to that subset. What are some of the key factors you think are important to look at?
Yeah, it might be, well, first of all, does it help to talk about just, you know, several of the key parameters that we often see people using with ETFs?
Yeah, I think that'd be very helpful.
Okay, so, you know, just some metrics that a lot of people evaluating ETFs tend to screen on is, hey, what's the expense ratio? What's the turnover ratio? You know, what's the tracking error? And I'm sure everybody knows tracking error is how closely does it follow the index that it's looking to mimic? You know, what's the total return? What's the alpha? What's the Sharpe ratio? You know, what's the drawdown? A lot of different factors that can be screened for. But, you know, if you take a very specific example and you say, hey, a individual investor or a wealth advisor on behalf of their customer wants to gain exposure to international small cap, you know, either growth or value, and they're very interested in increasing their exposure, but they're concerned about a couple key things. Not sure how all this China tariff stuff's going to play out, so interested in making sure exposure to China is limited, and then interested in making sure the expense ratio, which is always important, is, you know, less than 0.5. So you can quickly, if you apply some screens like that, you can quickly get yourself down from a list of 2,500 or 3,089 investable ETFs. You can quickly get your list down to 10 ETFs that you can now do a deep dive on.
And Sean, do you have all of the expected key metrics on ETFs available in Y charts? What does that look like just at a high level? And I guess along with that, as you screen through ETFs, can you then create a watch list to track these? Perhaps you don't want to make the investment now. You want to keep tabs on it. Just what does the data look like behind the scenes? And then how can you track that moving forward?
Yeah, so, I mean, we present any fundamental data point along with some calculations on top of that that could be available. So, talking through the example you mentioned, you get your list down to 10 securities. And you create a quick comparables table that shows for each of those 10 securities, what's the expense ratio, what's the one-year tracking error, what's the one-year tax cost ratio, what is the exposure to China, what's the total Asia exposure. You get that together, and then you say, much like buying a home, again, you say, well, which of those factors is proportionately more important to me? And you can create a way to score those 10 choices. So you might say, hey, of most importance to me is this exposure to China factor. Second biggest factor for me is expense ratio, and third is tracking error. You can create a scoring model that gets applied to these 10 securities, and then it's going to rank order them in order of the factors that are most important to you. And then you can go deep right now, or you can save this off, as you're mentioning, as as a watch list. A metrics list, and saving it off as a watch list, guess what? It's going to update when a new fund meets those parameters. So the next time in our system, at least, when you come in, you're going to see that the 10 that you had actually has slipped into 9 because one of those factors actually evolved through time with one of those funds.
Are there specific areas where you see investors or advisors make mistakes in the ETF due diligence process, or as you talk to investors and advisors, areas where you think mistakes are being made? And if so, what are those?
I see sometimes investors say, with all of this complexity out there, I want to reach a decision, and so I'm going to do that based on the latest thing I saw in the press on a fund, or on maybe some factors that may not be right for them. So it's a quick decision made, mm-hmm. because making a better decision seemed too complicated for them. And again, that's the kind of thing we try to solve at Y-Charts, is we try to say, hey, there is a lot of complexity here, but how can we make that really easy so that a tough decision can be made in 5, 10, 15 minutes?
Sean, at a broader level, I know Y-Charts has a feature where investors can input an entire ETF model portfolio and then run the underlying analytics. So let's say you've gone through this ETF due diligence process we're talking about for each asset class. You have your specific ETFs and you're now ready to construct a full portfolio. You can do that in Y-Charts. What are some of the data points or analytics that come out of that process?
Yeah, so ultimately, any individual ETF or equity that you might have selected fits into a basket of overall assets. I have never heard of an individual, or I've never heard of a prudent individual or prudent advisor who says, put all your eggs in this basket here. It's usually part of a multi-piece basket of securities. So the thing you're mentioning is, hey, let's say we settled our screen and we said, hey, we're going to pick the best candidate for our screen, which is the Schwab International Small Cap ETF, which is ticker SCHC. Well, that fits in with some Amazon stocks. It fits in with, a SPY and other ETFs that are out there into a portfolio. What we allow you to do is take that, all those things together, combine them, and they look like a single security with single performance characteristics, risk factors, and exposures. And now we let you, as an individual or as an advisor on behalf of your clients, look at how that portfolio might compare to an equally, a model 60-40 portfolio. And you can see how the various characteristics compare and feel comfortable that hypothetically speaking, you know, if you'd owned this model a year ago, 2 years ago, 5 years ago, it would have outperformed the indices along certain characteristics.
Right. So what you're saying is you can go and effectively backtest that portfolio.
Correct. Correct.
Okay. And then, Sean, lastly, what about just broader fund flows? Can you pull ETF flows for different asset classes, you know, different segments of the market? And if so, how do you think those should be used sort of as part of this entire process?
You know, I much like any investing, you need to be careful of looking too much in the rearview mirror when you're trying to drive the car. We produce monthly fund flow reports, which helps our customers understand the sectors that funds are flowing into and out of. I always think it's a good test, and usually made towards the end of the process, to say, hey, if I narrowed in on a security that's within a certain asset class or a certain fund flow category, what's going on at the macro level? What is aggregate money doing? Is it tend to be flowing into that sector, or is it flowing out? And again, it's a test you should do, and you should say, I feel comfortable that the investment I'm going to make runs counter to the funds flow, or I feel comfortable that the investment I'm going to make complies with the funds flow. I do think that's a macro check that investors should make.
Well, Sean, really appreciate you joining us this week. Love what your team is doing there at YCharts. Congratulations on all the success so far. Look forward to visiting again soon. Thank you.
Thanks for having me on, Nate.
That was Sean Brown, CEO of YCharts. That'll do it for this week's ETF Prime. I want to thank our exclusive sponsor, Legg Mason. You can visit leggmason.com to learn more about their broad range of investment strategies. If you enjoyed this week's podcast, we would greatly appreciate it if you could drop us a quick review wherever you listen to podcasts. That helps other listeners find the show. You can also send us comments on Twitter at ETF Prime. Thanks for joining me this week, everyone.